sexuality, I wanted to name this a different title. I wanted to put it, Fear is for Sale. That may sound a little odd until you really look at what's going on in our current global climate. Not our LA County, Long Beach, California, United States. It's a global climate of frustration everywhere around. And while you're frustrated, people are taking advantage of you, me, and each other. Seems like greed has no bounds. People love to scare people to make money. Oh, think about it. You're watching certain channels because we're told how bad the pandemic is, and the pandemic is bad. And you know, I have good news. The numbers here in the LA County are down around 10, so we're getting closer to that 8 numbers, so hopefully we can open soon. But people are making money. We get addicted to watching certain news channel. You ever notice they never tell the good news? They never say anything positive. It's stuff to get you upset. It's stuff to bother you, and you get addicted to these, and the endorphins and the dopamines. You're all firing, and we can't help but watch it. We watch certain social media channels, YouTube channels. It's the same rhetoric. It's all doom and gloom. And we hear people saying, we're living in the end of days. It's the mark of the beast. And it's on and on. And what you may not know as you get addicted to watching these with your dopamines, no different than a heroin addict, you're watching it, you're getting your daily dose of your drug, the ratings go up. That's why it's addicting. They want to get you addicted to it. So the ratings go up so they can sell the commercials for more money. Same as social media. Do you realize people are making millions of dollars every month? An individual is making millions of dollars every month because of the amount of views being watched, because, again, we get addicted to it. You ever notice we don't get addicted to the good news, the positive stuff? There's a reason why they say if it bleeds, it leads, right? And as we constantly have to dive in and watch these things, we in the Christian community are leaving our sacred worldview and only focusing on the secular. And it bothers me as a shepherd. You're my flock. To stand by and watch this happening over and over and over again, and people are consistently getting frustration, they're getting irritable, or the link I put up yesterday, we're getting ornery, right? That's a farm boy term. We're getting ornery with each other. But listen, as your shepherd, your pastor, whatever you want to call me, maybe just Brad, I want to help you out this morning. I want to start busting some myths during the months of August. And they're all based around the end of times, right? So during this month, we're going to go to School of Theology, and we're going to study eschatology. It's the study of the end of times. There's a lot of people speaking on behalf of God. And I can tell you now, it's a bunch of malarkey. It really is. People like, we're living in the end days. We're in the end days. No, you're not. You're in the end of times. We've been in the end of times since Jesus ascended into heaven, right? That's over 2,500 years ago. So yeah, we're end of times. We're not at the beginning. That's the Old Testament. We're at the end of times. But are we in the last days? No. Is a computer chip or a mask or an antidote for COVID the mark of the beast or monster energy? No, that's foolish talk of paranoia, right? Am I or Donald Trump or Obama the Antichrist? No, we're not. Listen, there's a lot going on that people have no idea about what the truth is. And the bad thing about it, we're getting all this information from other places than the Bible. And we must root everything in the Bible and what it actually says. And you got to look at the holistic approach to it, not just be a one-verse theologian, right? Listen, during this, you have to realize, I got 20, 30 minutes. That's it. So I'm not going to be able to do an in-depth Bible study of the end of times. Listen, that takes years to perfect. If anyone says they haven't figured out, be scared of them, right? There's a lot of theologians, they teach us for a living, and they spend years, and they're still learning. I'm still learning this book, right? Don't get lost on the trees, right? We're going to talk about five trees, but if you only focus on these trees during this series, you're going to miss the whole forest, right? Because when it comes to the Word of God, you can't focus on just the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation and think you've got to figure it out for the end of times. Matter of fact, Jesus' words are good enough, aren't they? If Jesus is our Savior, if Jesus is the Son of God, if the red letters mean what they mean, could you and I agree that Jesus is the authority on the end of times? And what he has to say is good enough. Now, if you want to go do a study, I'm going to encourage that. I'm going to encourage you to start in the book of Daniel, then to go to the book of Revelation, and so on. But Jesus is good enough. And there's some events, right? And when we talk about we're in the end of times and the end of days, listen, some major things have to happen before all this ends, right? I mean, you do know about the 7 years of tribulation. It starts off with 3 years of perfect peace. Have you seen a day of perfect peace lately? Even before COVID, we haven't had peace. All you got to do is go to the Middle East. There's always things going on. We're not in the last days. I'm sorry. Right? Listen, that hasn't happened. Even in the tribulation, do you realize there's certain things going to happen like the continuing the reign of the Antichrist? Right? He hasn't shown up yet. The restoration of Jews to Israel, they're still not there. The conversion of the remnant of Israel, that hasn't happened yet. The rebuilding of the temple, that hasn't happened yet. Sacrifices restored. I don't know about you guys, we just asked for tithes and offerings and that's not that good. I don't think anybody's coming here with grain offerings. I don't think anybody's coming here with doves to be sacrificed. I haven't killed a bull or a ram here yet, so that's not happening. So we must not be at the end of days. So we're not in the 7 years of tribulation, and nobody's taking on the mark of the beast. And just so you know, we're going to talk about this next week. The mark of the beast, you cannot be conned into the mark of the beast. Do you realize that? Taking on the mark of the beast means you're going to make a conscious effort to leave God and Jesus and accept Satan as your Savior. It cannot be, you cannot be slipped in it. That's why it's not a computer chip. You literally have to make a conscious effort. You have to make this decision. So it's not a computer chip. Guess what? It's not in there. You're being lied to. You should be upset. We look foolish. It's not Monster Energy drink. It's not a mask on your face. It's not an antivirus. It's none of that. Stop buying into the dopamines of what you're buying into. Open the Bible. The truth is in here, and the truth will set you free, right? But even after the 7 years of tribulation, we know there's rapture where Jesus comes back. We're going to meet him in the air. The born-again Christians, right? Living and dead. I'm going to make that clause there. Not people who have one of these Bibles, show up to church, have good lip service, and that's it. Jesus called people like that whitewashed tombs. They look good on the outside. The inside is dead, right? God knows our intentions. Jesus knows our intentions. And when you and I get judged, it's going to be our heart, not our mouths, right? He says, our mouths glorify me, but the hearts are far from me. So the born-again Christians, the devout Christians, are going to be raptured, taken to heaven. Jesus will talk about that here in a few minutes, while the rest stay here. And when they stay here, then we got to talk about the millennium. There will be 1,000 years of peace. Are you aware of that? Before Christ comes back, there will be 1,000 years of peace. As we said a few minutes ago, we haven't even had a day. But it all starts with 3 years. And before Jesus comes back, we've got 1,000 years of peace. And then after that, then Armageddon starts. That's the battle. Now we're living in the last of days. Then you're in the final days when this battle happens. But how do we get so mixed up? You ever thought about that? When we bust a myth, we just talked about the things that got to happen before Jesus comes back, and none of that's happened. How do we get so addicted to bad information? This is about a year and a half ago. Susan and I started taking the care of the Beggs family, Charles and Donna Beggs. And in the midst of doing anything, it was amazing how much propaganda came through the mail slot every day. Give money to the Jews for Jesus, otherwise the Jews will never make it to heaven. Give money to this political party, otherwise Christianity will die in America. I didn't know Christianity hinged upon politics. I thought it hinged on our obedience to this, right? See, we have to realize everybody's pulling strings. Everybody wants your money. They know what you like, right? It's kind of like you ever say anything, next thing you know, your phone blows up with it, right? One time I was talking about a motorcycle, and next thing you know, there's ads for that motorcycle on my phone. We always say in the paranoia, Big Daddy's listening, right? So is God. So is Satan, right? But we get propaganda shoved through our mail slots. It's on our news. It's everywhere else. They know what you like, and if you're a Christian, people know to take advantage of your Christianity by making you feel as if you don't give money here, you don't vote here, and if you don't do this here, Christianity will die. Christianity will die when you and I stop reading our Bibles and praying and being faithful to what it says. That's when Christianity will die, but it will only die in you, right? You are not the savior of the world. You are not the hero. That's Jesus' job, right? The Apostle Paul says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling and supplication. You and I are supposed to be in this. The problem is we're watching way too much TV news. We're listening to too many people on social media, and we don't even touch this. We let false prophets tell us that they're speaking on behalf of God or Scripture, and we're buying it hook, line, and sinker, and we're running around with signs screaming, the end is near, the end is near. This is a... Listen, I remember years ago I was watching Men in Black. I don't know if you remember, Will Smith, Tommy Lee Jones, it's at the end of the very first one, and everything's about to blow up, and Will Smith is going crazy, and Tommy Lee Jones just smacks him across his face and says, what's wrong with you? And Will Smith's like, the earth is going to be destroyed in 37 seconds. And Tommy Lee Jones goes, it's always going to be destroyed in 37 seconds. Get a hold of yourself so we can stop it. Listen, I want to tell you as your friend, get a hold of yourself. Quit letting people lie to you and take advantage of you. Quit letting them make money on your fear and paranoia. As I said months ago, we are nature. We are creatures that are stricken with fear. That's what sin has done to us, right? Listen, we know the lion and the lamb, or actually the wolf and the lamb will lay down, but if you ever watch wildlife, they're scared. They're scared of everything. Listen, I'm about to go deer hunting next month. And a deer could be eating, and it's a nice little thing that it moves, it stops, it looks, because it's scared something's going to happen to it, and it runs. And you and I are the same way. We forget that fear is part of sin in the world. But yet, in God's word, it tells us every day of the year, do not fear. But we live in a lot of fear. And a lot of people are living in fear that we're living in the last days, but all they're doing is like the little children's book I read as a kid about Chicken Little. And Chicken Little had Chicken Little faith, and he was always screaming, the sky is falling. We're doing the same thing. Listen, I love you. I want you to live abundantly. I want you to live boldly. I want you to live with love and encouragement like Jesus did, not running around screaming the end is near. Matter of fact, Jesus warns us that those who run around screaming, the end is near, that we're supposed to stop listening to them. Did you know that? The word of the Lord, I'm going to read it here in just a minute. Jesus says, don't listen to them. They don't come in my name. Matter of fact, let me jump into it. It says this in Luke chapter 21, verses 15 through 19. And I mark this in your Bible. It's good. And if you're watching online, I think some of the words are underlined because I really want you to get this, right? It says, some of his disciples were remarking about how the temple was adorned with beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus says, as for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on the other. Every one of them will be thrown down. Teacher, they replied, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place? Jesus replied, watch out that you are not deceived. For many will come in my name, claiming I am he, and the time is near. Do not follow them, word of the Lord. When you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away. Word of the Lord. Then he said to him, nation will rise up against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes and famines and pestilence in various places and fearful events and great signs from heaven. But before all this, they will seize you, persecute you. They will hand you over to the synagogues, put you in prison, and you will be brought before the king and governors and all the accounts of my name. And so you will bear testimony to me. But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourself. Remember he said, don't worry. For I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict. You will be betrayed even by your parents, brothers, sisters, relatives, and friends. And they'll put some of you to death. Everyone will hate you because of me. But not one hair on your head will perish. Stand firm, and you will win life. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, help us understand that Jesus is the authority, the beginning and the end. And what he says is true. And when Jesus says, stop listening to this rhetoric, we learn to just stop listening to it. And when he says, this isn't the end, we realize it's not the end. And we learn what is truth, what's not truth. We learn, okay, this is a sign, that's not a sign. Lord, help us. Lord, in a lot of ways, we are lost sheep in need of a shepherd, for we're wandering aimlessly, and we're fearful. Lord, help us get focused, because, Lord, you want us to glorify you. We can't glorify you in fear. We can't glorify you in negativity and doom and gloom. That's what the secular does, and you call us to the sacred, because your death was worthy. The cross was sufficient. Your blood is more than enough. And Lord, through your blood, let us learn to love each other, to help the helpless. And God, this morning, help us with clarity and a dignity and strength in your faith and your word and in your name. Amen. There's a lot of people speaking on behalf of God. There always has been, always will be. And even Jesus says, they're going to come in my name, say the end of the day. Don't listen to them. So next time someone tells you, we're in the last days, do me a favor, do Christianity a favor, and stop listening to them. The longer you give them an ear, the more platform you give them. This is how charlatans and false prophets continue to grow, because we give them a listening ear, because we're addicted to it. We're addicted to the drama. We're addicted to the end of times and all that. But listen, let me tell you about a gentleman named William Miller. He had a wife, Ellen, who takes over his ministry years ago. They started the Adventist church. One day, William decided that they were going to take and predict the end of times. Matter of fact, let me go back. Did you know that the Seventh-day Adventist church and the Jehovah's Witnesses began on this very platform by this man and his wife? We all know one's a cult. We haven't figured out the other one is as well. But the Seventh-day Adventist and the Jehovah's Witness church hinge upon the same predictions of the end of time. But William Miller, he decided he was going to predict that Jesus is coming back on March 21st, 1842. Shortly after he did, I realized, ooh, I had it wrong. So he changed the date to a little more than a year later to April 3rd, 1843. And he made this prediction. As you can tell, it didn't happen. And you would figure that the Adventist church would just die off, right? The Bible says when somebody comes and is prophesying, makes predictions, and it doesn't come through, we're to throw them out of the church. You ever know that? We have a whole lot of people walk around churches every day, faith healing, and it's not true, but we let them keep playing around. We have people prophesying that never come true, and we just keep them around because they've been fooled and deceived. The Bible is very clear. When someone is prophesying, predicting, and it doesn't come true, there are false prophets, throw them out, right? Unless they have a submissive heart, willing to learn. Because a lot of people love the attention on them. Fear is for sale. But let's get back to William Miller. So he realizes, oh, I made a mistake. Let me recalculate it to April 18th, 1844. Oh, it was all a buzz. Everything keeps going. But then on the second prediction, it didn't come true again. And you figure it would have all died, right? It would have given up. I mean, here's the second prophecy prediction of the coming of Christ, and it didn't come true. All of a sudden, William Miller decided, oh my gosh, I've been counting Sunday as the Sabbath, not Saturday. And so my calculation is way off. I got to rework this, and now I'm going to be able to predict the coming of Christ. So he made the third prediction, October 22nd, 1844. And all of a sudden, people start coming back. Feeding frenzies on the predictions get bigger and bigger. In the Millerite publication, True Midnight Cry, they start saying things. The time is short. Prepare to meet thy God. The Lord is coming. The end is near. Oh, they were all in a feeding frenzy to the point where fields were left unharvested. Shops were closed. People quit their jobs, paid their debts, freely gave away all their possessions with no thought of repayment. Oh, the frenzy was happening. We love a good end of time story, don't we? Miller even started selling ascension robes to the faithful. And those who didn't buy into this prediction, they started telling them that they were Babylonian people, that they were demons. Today we'd call them communists or Nazis or Trumpers or bombers. You know, we love to insult people with name-calling. I don't know when we thought name-calling was Christian. It's not. It's actually the opposite of Christianity. We teach our kids to not call each other names. Somehow it's become cool to be a Christian and call each other a name since we disagree. Follow this, the sacred, not the secular. But back to Miller. He's selling the ascension robes, and people literally go outside. They start digging their own graves. And these people stand in their graves, and they're bought and sold ascension robes, and guess what? We're still here. It didn't happen. And you would figure out that these places like the Seventh-day Adventist Church and the Jehovah's Witness Church would have been closed. But it's not true because we get so addicted to the dopamines and endorphamines because we love a good story because we really don't like the truth. But see, the truth will set you free. When you and I focus on the truth, we focus on what Jesus says and only what Jesus says. And when somebody says something, we double check it with the Bible, right? This is the anchor. This is where we need to check something, right? Matter of fact, Jesus even addresses the rapture, and you may not even know that. Turn with me in Matthew chapter 24, verses 36 to 43. Jesus talks about it. He wants us to understand certain things. So here's what it says. About the hour and the day, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Not William Miller and his wife Ellen Miller, who actually made 30,000 other prophecies, and none of them have came true. I can tell you now, if somebody tells you that Jesus is coming back a certain day, right? Remember Y2K and all these other things. When somebody says that, you can mark that in your book. Jesus not coming that day. Nobody knows. If you act like you know, then you'd be like, I knew it. No, nobody knows. Nobody. Word of the Lord. As it was in the days of Noah, so it'll be in the coming days of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking and marrying and giving into marriage up to the day Noah entered the ark. And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them away. This is how it'll be the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field, one will be taking the other one up. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken, the other one left. Therefore, keep watch. You do not know on what day the Lord will come. But understand this. If the owner of the house had known what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would not have left this house broken into. This is something we want to talk about here in just a minute, that last little line. But again, by what Jesus is saying, we're not in the end days. You don't know when it is. I don't know when it is. Jesus even says he doesn't know when it is, right? But again, fear is for sale. We get addicted to all this. I can't remember which cowboy movie. I love Westerns. My daughter Taylor sitting there, we used to watch all these Westerns together. But there was one, I can't remember. I don't think it's Tombstone. But in it, he goes, get busy living or get busy dying. And how about you? I want to get busy living. I don't want to wait till I die to begin to live. I want to enjoy this life Christ has given me. I want to love my family. I want to be crazy. I want to be reckless with trying different things, eating things, exploring stuff. God gave us an entire universe to explore. Why are we not having fun and living this radical, exciting, sacred, God-fearing, God-loving lives? Instead, we sit around with demonic blindfolds on, screaming, the end is near. This is the mark of the beast. This is it. That's not the life you and I were created for. You and I were created to be God's most sacred, beautiful, creative creation. Think about when you look around, the creativity going on. You're watching me in your living room from a distance. There must be something unique about humanity for us to figure out how to invent and create all this and harness electricity. There's so much creativity God has put in you, but you're not going to find it. You're not finding your gifts, your talents, your creativity if you're living in fear. You're just standing around screaming, the end is near, and you got to keep turning on the TV. You got to keep going to this YouTube channel, this Facebook page, because you're addicted. And I'm telling you, that's where the thief is getting you. You do realize Satan's coming for you, and he may already have you. He's got you on a leash, and you don't even know it. But if we're talking about the end of times, I think there's three important things we got to realize. The first is, Jesus is coming back. He says that himself, right? When we take communion, this is the first Sunday of the month, normally we take communion, and at the end of it, it says we will continue to take communion until he comes again. He is coming again. Have hope. Jesus is coming again. And if you're a born-again Christian, if you're a devout follower of Jesus, you're doing what he says to do, you're not doing what he says not to do, then you've got nothing to live in fear. Listen, Jesus can come back today if that's what he wants. If his Father, God in heaven, tells Jesus, now's the time, well, praise God. That's great. I'm okay with that. You should be okay with that if you're a real Christian. Remember, God's judging your heart, right? Because what's in here is coming out of here. And half the time what you're putting up here is suffocating in here and regurgitating out. Make sure you're a devout Christian, a true follower of Jesus, right? He is coming back. And that's good or bad, depending on how you live your life. But he is coming. But the second part is, since we're here, God has work for us to do here on earth. He hasn't left us just to meander around the planet or the universe. There's a purpose for everyone's creation story. What's yours, right? Listen, we're called to live a Christian life in community with fellowship with God, with each other, even with ourselves. We're supposed to share the good news of Jesus Christ with everyone around, not going around screaming chicken little faith. Listen, let me read you the other part in Matthew, verses 42 through 44, the end there. It says, therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day the Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known what time the night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would have not let his house be broken in. So you must also be ready, because the Son of Man will come in an hour when you don't expect him. What Jesus is saying is, stop living secular. You don't know when I'm coming. Be ready, day or night, right? That's not in paranoia. That's not in fear. He's just saying live an authentic Christian life because you don't know. And if you're not living an authentic Christian life, the devil's breaking in. And he has stole your joy, your hope, your happiness, your peace, your patience, your kindness. He's stealing it all. And you're not ready for Jesus to come. And when he comes, you're going to be found wanting. Hoping you could go back, and it's just not going to happen. There's no purgatory. There's not a do-over. Do it right now. Salvation, heaven depends on it. Amen? Listen, the thief, the devil, he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. For a lot of people, he's killing your faith and your hope in him. And we're putting it in the secular world, even though we say we are, you know, sacred focused. What I hear is a lot of secular. You're a child of God. There's something special about you. You were created unique. Listen, I love telling people, you can love Jesus and be absolutely crazy. I'm crazier now than when I was before I got saved. Because I know God is there. He's watching me. I know how this ends. I don't have to stand there and have chicken little faith. I know in the end what this says, back page, God wins. Right? And until then, I know I got a whole world I get to explore. Right? Somehow God let us invent dirt bikes. That's a great thing for me. Right? He invented parachutes, so I've jumped out of a plane. He invented bungee cords. I don't fear. You know what I fear? God and my wife, and sometimes my daughter. That's it. I don't have to fear anything else. I vote my conscience. I love people. Listen, we get hurt. That's one of the things about trusting and putting ourselves out there. You will get hurt, but things will get better. Trust God, right? Trust Jesus. Trust that when Jesus comes back, it's okay. Martin Luther is famous for saying, if he knew Jesus was coming back tomorrow, he'd still plant a tree today, right? And it goes off, Jesus says, why do you worry about tomorrow? Today's got enough for itself. We're always worried about the tomorrows. How about taking care of today? How about living the best you can today? And listen, this is not your best life. If you believe this is your best life, you have a low expectation of heaven, right? I want to live a great, crazy life. And whenever someone is standing up here at my funeral, I want them to go, I cannot believe he died like that. I want to take an abundance of this life. I can't do that if I'm scared of it. I'm not. God created me with this crazy radical. I feel like I'm the poster child for the next generation. I'll do anything to the extreme because I think that's what God has called me to do. Just extremely love people, extremely forgive people. Just, I want to be the best I can be for God, for you, for me, for my family. I don't have time for the drama. I don't have time for all the minutia. I just don't, right? God's got work for me to do. And I want to encourage you to do the same. And the third thing is simple. Stop stargazing, but be on alert, but don't stargaze. Listen, whenever Jesus ascends to heaven, it says this in Acts 1, what happens, right? Jesus going up, the disciples stand there, verse 10, 11, it says this, and while they were steadily looking, steadily, which means, while they were steadily staring upwards to heaven, as Jesus went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel. And they said to him, men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up to heaven? The same Jesus who is taken up for you into heaven will come down in a like manner as you saw him go into heaven. Right? You don't have to stand around and stare into heaven. He's coming back. Be ready. Don't let Satan steal your time. Stop worrying about the end of days and worry about the days you're alive. What are you doing with them? What is your story? Paranoia? Fear? Come on, that's not the story that Jesus died for you in. See, Jesus died for you because there's a great story in you of a great man or woman, child. God has greatness in store for you. But if you're living in fear and paranoia because somebody told you something that's nothing more than a myth, listen, you got to change direction. Get out of the secular and get into the sacred, because I'm telling you, the sacred is the best life. It really is. It's fun. It's a blessed life. And listen, the best blessing is joy and love and knowing that our Father in heaven cares for us and that we have the opportunity to share our faith with others around us. Listen, I want to pray for you real quick. Maybe you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe you don't understand that there is a sacred life that is the best life, right? And maybe you've given your life to Jesus, but some of the minutiae in this world has overtaken you. You lost your focus. You stopped looking to Jesus and you're looking to man. Listen, I want to encourage you this morning. Change directions. That's the great thing about the Christian faith. We can change directions. He is an all-loving God. He is a new direction God, a new life, right? He says we become new creatures in Christ. And I pray that's for you today. But let me pray. Would you pray these prayers with me? Father, we do love you. And Lord, I pray for those who have never accepted you as Lord and Savior. Lord, as they now submit their lives to you and they ask you to forgive them, Lord, would you infill them with the Holy Spirit? And would you walk with them in their days forward? Lord, letting them know which way to go. Lord, just taking all bitter roots out of them. All the negativity, all the hurtful things we say to each other, all the junk this world has to offer. And Lord, would you fill them with your spirit of love and kindness and peace and patience, joy. Oh, Lord, we need more joy. And Lord, for us who have called ourselves your children, Lord, let us not be whitewashed tombs who just look good on the outside, but it's just dead bones on the inside. Lord, would you get these bones a-rattling like you did in Ezekiel again? Would you bring us back to life? Would you get us focused on living an abundant life? Lord, would you give us the self-control to turn off the junk and turn on our Bibles as we get into your word? And Lord, let us be good representation of Christianity. Let us no longer be deceived by this world in its ways. But Lord, we love you. Would you speak to all of us this morning so we can start to live the life you gave us, that we not waste our life, we not waste our witness because of the world. And Lord, would you bless us? Would you give us our joy back? Help us trust you where we don't understand. Lord, there's so many times I shake my head at the world, I just don't understand. And I too am greatly bothered. But remind us to go back to you and everything. Where you said in this world you will have trouble, but we're supposed to be of good cheer because you overcame the world. Lord, remind us of your word. Give us your spirit to remind us as you said. It would remind us of everything you've said. And Lord, we need you. We need you more than the world. We need the sacred inside your creation. And Lord, would you push out the secular? So we know how to love and encourage again. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, in case I haven't told you lately, God loves you, and so do I. I'll see you soon.